And as the bells of St. Peter and St. Paul ring out here in Horndon on the Hill, well, they've just stopped, hasn't it? But it's a very warm welcome to SEHB television. We're here at the Horndon on the Hill Feast and Fair. And our visitor this year's fair seems to bring out all the best in the village. It all started back in 1974 when the Horndon Society revived the idea of an old medieval fair, which parish records tell us goes back to the granting of a charter by King Edward I. Well, that was way back in the medieval ages, but today it's all changed.
Well, there's no chance of it dying out at all, because today's feast and fair, as we shall soon see, has become part of village life. So for the next half hour, join us as South Essex Hospital Broadcasting Television brings you all the fun of Horndon on the Hill Feast and Fair.
And looks like you and I are going to be talking to various people and finding out what's happening around the village this weekend.
That's right, we'll be trying to capture some of the atmosphere and, of course, those old arts and crafts that people say have died out, but they're right here, aren't they?
Well, I'm told there are Vikings here today, there's a court jester and even glass blowing.
So come along with us
as we bring you all the fun of Horndon on the Hill Feast and Fair.
The Reverend David Williams and Graham Bright. First of all, let's talk to the vicar. Now, you're dressed in traditional medieval costume, aren't you?
More or less, yes. bit of cheating, bit of poetic license.
Well, describe it for us.
Well, I'm really wearing my usual cassock, but I'm hiding it a bit. An old hat I found in the cupboard.
Now, you've also got the jug of water. That's most important.
This is I'm sprinkling the worthy people of Horndon to bless them in their celebrations, as the clergy would have done in those days.
Would you have a rather unusual prayer? Can we ask you to perform it for us?
This isn't
now
a prayer. This is really a reading of the original charter. Sciatis non concessisi et hac carta nostra confirmasse dilecto nobis Roberto Gifford quod ipse et heredes sui in perpetuum habebat Julium Ferium apud Monerium suum de Honingden singulis annis per quatuor dies duratorum et in die festi beatorum Petri et Pauli apostolarum. That relates to the original granting of the charter by Edward I to the people of Horndon to one of his favourites, Robert Gifford, and he granted him an annual feast for the people, for himself and for the people of Horndon.
It must be
on the
right
eve of the Apostles Peter and Paul.
It must have been a right medieval rave up at that time.
It must have been.
Well, let's go across now to Graham. Graham, dressed in your monk's habits, you declared the feast and fair over again. It's the 10th one that's been held here.
That's right. We started it 10 years ago. The objective was to show people in this part of Essex that Horndon was a village that was quite unique, it had a character of its own, and it had a tremendous history. We've, of course, got the wool market in the village, which I think shows how important Horndon was back in the days when it was one of the centres for trading sheep's wool and things like that. And we revived the charter that the vicar's just told us about to bring the feast and fair back again. It wasn't something new, we're actually reviving it. And each year we try to bring a period to be, which is why you've got so many people in period dress. And I think we really have now put Horndon on the Hill on the map. It's grown and grown, and it's covering the whole village this year. And we do attract thousands of people from all parts. And when I was in Canada earlier this year, I actually found a Canadian recommending to me that I go to the feast and fair of Horndon on the Hill. So our favour's gone far and wide.
Well, best of luck. Let's hope the next 2 days go as well as the first half hour's gone. And I'll let you wander around the village dressed as a monk and a medieval vicar. Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Trudy Eden and Trudy, you've got some rather unusual shells and thingies on your table, haven't you? What are they?
Tortoise and mice.
Well, yes, but they look like seashells to me.
Oh, yes, yes, they are. They're made from seashells, my words are like that, which we really collected quite locally. We popped down to the other night and collected them. My husband made them.
Now, behind them, we've got the famous Horndon on the Hill hedgehogs.
Well, I think these have been everywhere, actually. They're just Horndon on the Hill, all over the world. And I think to date, we've made about 2,700.
Welcome to the field, because we've now come to see this exciting Viking fight. With me two Vikings. Now, who am I talking to?
Gillian,
what's going to happen?
Well, very briefly, we're starting with a funeral. There will be a disagreement as to who the heir to the village is. There will be a disagreement between the elder brother and the younger brother. There will be factions. However, without giving too much away in the script, an event will take place, which means the two factions have to join back up again to face a common enemy.
We'll find out who the common enemy is. So off, now, you're Saxon?
At the moment.
Two Saxons. Oh, well, the Saxons. We'll see who wins. So rather the Saxons, because of the Vikings who are going to be doing the raiding. They're taking their chieftain away. He died honourably in battle. And, well, I mean, they don't look very sort of intelligent Saxons. If they're not careful, they might well drop him. You can see over there, the Saxons are hanging around, as only Saxons can, of course. And they're waiting to receive their leader. Definitely looks as if there's a bit of an altercation going on. Chased off, but I think they're going to be back. Yes, well, I think he's going to come back. This is rather like Saturday night at the pub with Buzzard, isn't it, in a way? Let's take some nice quiet subject. Let's take glass blowing. Let's see. Beggars, and with me is Walt Tingle. Walt, they look marvellous behind us. What are you going to be doing?
Well, we're going to dance court dances from the 17th and 18th century in authentic costume and trying to recreate that period.
Where do you come from?
Well, we're all based in the Essex area.
Is there much demand for court dances? I mean, how do they differ from, shall we say, Morris dancing?
Oh, much more genteel. I mean, these were the dances of the aristocracy, and of course we are the aristocracy. There's no doubt about that. You've only got to look at them.
Well, I think we ought to have a look at some of the costumes here. I mean, our friend here with his back towards us. Now, this is typical of a Regency gentleman, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. A little bit earlier than Regency. All the men's costume, although they're made of different material, you'll find that they're all all of a similar style. They're based on about the 1690 period, 1690, 1695.
Well, let's ask this young lady to come towards us. Now, in the best approved manner of television, give us a twirl. There we are. Isn't it a beautiful scene? Now, for the benefit of our lady viewers, what's the material?
Most of it's velvet. There's a bit of silk. They all vary. Mm. There's some velvet, silk, whatever's suitable.
It looks heavy.
It is. It's very heavy.
Is it heavier to dance in?
You get used to it after a while, but it does get a bit heavy.
Well, I'll let you promenade on, and we look forward to the dances. Dancers from yesteryear. Let's now go to Kevin and find out what he's got for us at this year's Horndon Feast and Fair.
Amateur race is one of the main attractions here at the Feast and Fair. We have about 500 runners from all over the Essex County and also a lot of elite athletics names. They're about to start any moment now. The race, 10 kilometres, will take them all around Horndon. We're waiting for the rest of the athletes to take their places, and they should be starting any moment now. And they're off. The 500 runners begin their run of 10 kilometres around Horndon. People are cheering them on as they go past, limbs pounding. It's definitely going to be a test of stamina.
Which would be about 20 miles
wide. Wiggly of the Invicta Running Club, number 42. 10-kilometre race here at the Horndon Feast and Fair 1984 was John Wiggly of the Invicta Running Club. His time was just over 29 minutes. Well done, John. And for the others, well, it was a good race, wasn't it?
Put your hands together.
To Running Club, who has just won this year's Thurrock Harriers 10-kilometre race. How are you feeling, John?
Pretty good. I much enjoyed it. I was a bit apprehensive about the race before we started. I've had a busy week in the last week, but my teammate Merv Bramwood, we got going at about the first lap, halfway round, pulled away, and we just kept it going.
Your time was unofficially just over 29 minutes. Are you pleased with that?
I am pleased because the course is slightly extended this year. They've done a remeasuring job and it's exactly two laps start to finish. So we've run a little bit further than in the past, so I'm very pleased.
Now, John, you're a marathon man, aren't you? I mean, how does this compare?
I used to be a marathon man. I tried about five, six years ago and it didn't suit me at all. Whereas I found this distance I love. So I figured it was silly to keep banging your head against the wall, and I stayed with the distance I like.
I don't blame you. Any problems at all? I mean, what are the difficulties of this course?
The only problems with any course like this is very attractive, which is nice, but of course, going through country lanes, while we were running around the course before the start, there was a huge cart full of straw bales, and we were wondering, well, if this is here in half an hour's time, what sort of chaos is going to reign? But fortunately, it all cleared, but that's the only sort of problem, and there were none, so everything was fine.
Yes, of course, right at the end of the course, there's this terrible hill, isn't there? I mean, I'm sure that must be very difficult indeed.
Well, I've seen the hill before, and I knew one thing, that was that I didn't want to be with somebody at the bottom of it. I wanted to just cruise up and enjoy it, so
yes.
That's what happened.
Have you got some friends or relatives here sort of welcoming you in?
Yes, I've got my family here, and Merv Bramwell's got his family here as well, so it's a nice family day out.
Well, John, congratulations. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
The best places to be in the village is the Bell here at Horndon on the Hill, and it's an unusual pub because on the roof are some hot cross buns. Now, to tell us a story about hot cross buns, here's the barmaid. Now, tell us all about the hot cross buns.
Well, I believe it started in 1903 when one of the tenants came in on a Good Friday, which is the day you hang a hot cross bun, and it's continued ever since. And usually it's the oldest person in the village we try to get to hang the bun.
And I believe that during the war, when you couldn't actually make hot cross buns, they made them out of concrete.
Well, there is one that's made from cement.
Cement?
Well, concrete, whatever.
This is one of these pubs that's always packed out. It must be fun to work in.
Oh, yeah, it's great fun.
Now, I'm told this year there was a bit of aggro amongst the staff because you were supposed to wear Tudor costumes, but you're not, are you?
Well, no, we're not. No. Does it really matter?
I don't think so.
Do you think they look good?
I think they look just as beautiful. Anyway, I think now I'm here, I better have a pint of IPA.
Right, here we go then.
Oh, lovely.
Really?
Mmm. Look at that. Isn't it beautiful?
Let's hope it tastes as good as it.
Yes. There you are. That's what Horndon on the Hill Bell Public House is all about. Good beer. It's like that advert, you know. It's look good, it feels good, and by golly, it does you good. And these are the famous hot cross buns. If we start looking at this one, this is 1984, that's the latest. But going all the way back here, we go back to 1980, for example, and moving slowly down, these fossilised remains of hot cross buns begin to tell a history. This one's quite moth-eaten by, for example. And just look at the condition of these in the early 50s. If you ever thought your cakes were hard, just look at those. This one with the poppy hanging out of it is the famous 1945 hot cross bun put up there to celebrate the end of the war. And the one at the far end, it may look like a fossilised hot cross bun, actually it's concrete. But going on to the other side and coming back on the other side, we've got those which go back through the 30s and the 20s, all the way back in fact to 1903 when it first started. It's a nice custom, and if you're ever here in Horndon on the Hill, have a look at these hot cross buns, but please don't try eating them. Church, and we're looking at flowers. Now, they're not just any flowers, they're your flower arranging, aren't they?
That's right, yes. Not just mine, lots of girls have come along and helped us put this thing on for this weekend.
Okay, we've got a few of the selections of flowers here, so let's start looking at one of them. And I think the first one is this beautiful blue and purple concoction, if I can use such a word. What is it?
Yes. Well, this was inspired by Torval and Dean. They're the only people so far who've won a gold for us in the Olympics this year. The other Olympics haven't taken place yet, so it seemed right that we should actually have them as in pride of place in this arrangement. And hopefully with the swirls of cane and the lot of movement and the colour, it really does say Bolero and Torval and Dean to everybody who comes in to see it.
Margaret, this beautiful creation in red and white, what exactly are they? Carnations, I suppose.
Well, the flowers are carnations and gladioli, mainly. But it's actually representing the track events in the Olympic Games. And we've used the red and white, really, to signify the red track. And as you can see, there's the hurdle and the running shoes and even the baton, which they use in the relay races.
The centrepiece of the entire flower show, it's Olympics.
Olympics 84, yes. This is representing the flame, the opening ceremony of the Games. And we've used some rather exotic flowers here in the Birds of Paradise flowers coming down through the centre, and lots of yellow and orange and red gladioli. And I think the girl who's done this has captured the whole thing completely, and everybody has commented on the arrangement itself.
Margaret Lee, thank you very much for showing us the flowers in this flower show and telling us the story behind what at first sight looks to be just another display of flowers.
Thank you very much for showing your interest in the flower festival. Thank you very much indeed.
Okay.
Wow.
Enjoy the music of the Thameside Wakes, and at the moment they're playing Two Borés by Michael Wakes. Thameside Wakes in performance here on Horndon on the Hill. Just an example of the wide diversity of music and dance that can be found here over this weekend. And now, for something completely different.
We describe the scene that's down here at the Feast and Fair. We're broadcasting from a Southern Glass caravan, which is situated over in the corner here. First of all, we've got a wheel over here where the price is 20p. You pay 10p. If it lands on a red square, as you can see there, you win 20p. The man in charge today has been Bob Smith, if he gives a wave with the headphones on. By the caravan. In the caravan there, you may just be able to see Richard Clare, if he put his hand out and give us a big wave, Richard. And Keith in there?
Over in the corner there, I think Bob could talk to Dave and explain a bit more about the other games over there with the table tennis balls.
Man, Dave Ware. Everybody cheer when I say Dave Ware. This man, Dave Ware. Dave Ware's been running this game, and basically you've got to get your balls, if you pardon the expression, you've got to get three ping pong balls, and you've got to throw them, and see if you can get them in a jam jar, basically. Can you put that any more eloquently?
Well, this is the highlight of the Horndon show, actually. For a very modest sum of 10p, you get three balls, magic badge, a balloon, visuals, and lots of goodies, and you can also win a record from our SEHB crack box.
How many winners would you actually say we've had today, loosely speaking?
2,719.
And how many have we had playing?
2,718.
We're doing well. This is Dave Ware, the man who arranges all the money that SEHB has been raising for the last 200 years.
Great.
Now, Richard has told me that the next record, he's given me the sleeve. And Dave, I can't work out, is this Bronski beat by Small Town Boy, or is this Small Town Boy by Bronski beat?
Actually, it's Max Bygraves doing Small Town Boy.
Small Town Boy.
Arsenal!
Well, that was interesting, wasn't it, Kevin? What a wonderful weekend we've had.
We have indeed, yes. We've met some interesting people. We've seen some very interesting things, haven't we?
Well, I certainly think we ought to be back next year for another Horndon Feast and Fair, but what memories are you going to take away from this year's?
Summed up in one word, I think, Dennis, hedgehogs.
Hedgehogs, yes. They were the star of last year's festival. I think they're definitely the star of this year's.
Definitely, yes. I'm taking home a gross, at least, I think.
Well, from all of us here at the Horndon on the Hill Feast and Fair, Dennis Rocard and Kevin Fairbanks say, bye for now. Thanks a lot for joining us, and get well soon.
Bye-bye. The top of 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 the top of